Most human traits are not single gene traits, they're polygenic. There's multiple genes involved, and we now have a state of understanding that we know that genes aren't always on or always off. Environmental influences can influence our actual gene structures, and they may activate or deactivate at different times for different reasons. That's kind of poorly understood, what reasons at what times and which genes, but we now realize it's not just a static code that sits there and emits, and there's a bunch of dead material in there, right? A bunch of redundant, useless DNA material. So anytime we say something's genetic, you should automatically now, as non-lay people in this subject, go, it's probably more complicated than that. So one thing we see that has one of the strongest genetic influences is intelligence. There is evidence for a pretty big genetic contribution to intelligence, although I would argue it's not nearly as big as some people would make it out to be. John Locke, on the flip side, if you know of the tabula rasa, right? Lockean, some of you know political science, right? Philosophy holds that we just get born and we're a blank slate, and everything that we know and do is environment. It's environmental influence. It's not that either. It's not all one or all the other. It's more complicated than that. So just to look at it, you see the generic similarity studies help us determine relative contributions in a very general sense. Identical twins have 100% genetic similarity. Fraternal twins have 50% genetic similarity, and unrelated people have 0%. Well, of course they have some genetic similarity because we all have the same structure when we talk about breaking that code, right? Understanding the genome. Well, we all have 99.9-something% similarity. That's what makes us a species. That's what differentiates us from other species who also share large portions of that DNA in the sense that they're mammals or that they're fish or that they're whatever. But as an individual, you are unique in the sense that what makes you you is still your genome. It's not the human genome, it's the human individual's genome that we're talking about here. And that's where people get a little bit off base. So if we look at it that way, we can now look at correlations. Now, correlations are not causal, we know this. But we do see relationships, and we can make some inferences from these, right? Keep in mind, correlations are under inferential statistics. There's other of them. If intelligence was due solely to heredity, then averages between intelligence scores should decrease as genetic similarity decreases. That is the case. That's what happened. However, results also support environmental influences. So if I'm looking at identical twins reared together, so they are virtually identical, but you know that they're not identical exactly. They're not the same soul. They're not the same human being. Most of you know of Mary-Kate and Ashley Olsen, right, on this Full House, and they made millions of dollars pretending to be the same human being, right? Because they looked identical. They sounded identical, and they could act identical, right? And that worked for them for a long time. But when they became adults, even though they were making big money, they took a lot of pains to show how different they really are, right? They are not, if you know identical twins, you might have a hard time telling them apart from appearance, but you know they're different people. Being of the same genetic variety does not make you an identical soul. These are two different people. So what we have is two people who look identical, who share virtually all of their genetic material, who are now in a shared environment. So if we raise them together, the correlation is 0.86 or so. That's pretty high, right? That's like, wow, man, you don't ever see correlations that high in human affairs. So if you were not sophisticated with your statistics, you go, look, man, it must be all genetic because that's a really high correlation. It's almost one. And we know one's a perfect correlation. But if you raise them apart, it falls to roughly 0.72. Now the unsophisticated would go, well, what's the difference, all right? 0.8 something, 0.7 something, that's virtually the same thing, but it's not the same thing. To understand shared variance, how much is overlap, and we don't know which part of the overlap is which. To see the shared variance, you square that number. You square the correlation to see how much should be from very similar influences in your outcome. Our outcome in this case is intelligence test score, right? And we already know all the issues about the intelligence testing itself. right? And what we see is that drop equates to this. If it's 0.86 squaring, it means 74% of the variance is shared. And that seems like a pretty strong, it's a pretty strong argument that there's a heavy genetic influence here, right? But you drop it down to 0.72, and that shared variance goes down to 52%. 52%, meaning at best, you've got 50% from genetic similarity. Because now we're rearing them in two different environments, right? But what? What else is the same about them? Their looks. Do we treat people differently because of how they look in this society or any society historically?
Nah.
Because of their skin color, their hair color, their eye color, their attractiveness levels, their whatever height. You ever see somebody who's really tall and they're like, hey, what basketball team do you play for? And they go, I don't play basketball. Right? Because people make giant assumptions about appearances. They act on those assumptions as though those assumptions are valid. So here's the thing. Even though we've got identical twins in different environments, we're at best, we're looking at 50% now shared variance in their outcome scores. One thing that they still have in common is, for better or for worse, fair or unfair, they're going to be treated similarly based on an appearance because they look the same. Right? And so there is still shared environmental influence, although it's much harder to nail down. And people are very quick to point out similarities. You're like, look, these two haven't even known each other, and they got together, and they like the same beer. Right? They watch the same sports team. But it's really easy to pick out a couple things that are the same and go make a big deal out of that. Like if you went out and saw a license plate and it said 572 KJH, and went, look at that. Out of all the license plates I could have seen today, 572 KJH, wow! And ignore all the differences that occurred the rest of the day, right? So what is making a big deal out of the few things that are the same do? It ignores all the differences and upplays the similarity to give you the illusion that there's more than there might be to this. So yes, genetics count, but we're looking at less than 50% of the variance accounted for. So they count less than half. They still count, but be careful what kinds of assumptions you make based on these stereotypes that we have about people. So that's just a chart there, and different studies find different things, you know. Same person tested twice, genetic similarity is 100% because it's you, and you do pretty much what you did last time. What does that show? If you can retest somebody, it shows reliability, right? You would expect it, but it's not perfect, is it? Because there's some measurement error. On a different day, you do different performance. So it shows there's variability even in your own performance over time. Now we got identical twins reared together, identical twins reared apart. Genetic similarity, 100%. But what do we got? Reared together, a very high correlation. And then we drop it when we rear them apart. And you square it and you find out what shared variance is. And then you get fraternal twins. Well, those are people who have two different eggs and two different sperm. No different than a brother or a brother pair or sister pair who are born a year apart, right? Their genetic similarity is the same. It's random. Which egg, which sperm, which 23 chromosomes from the mother, which 23 chromosomes from the father. So they share that genetic link of mother and father if they're fraternal twins. And what we see is, you know, they have 50% similarity. Reared together, you got a much higher correlation than reared apart. Here's biological siblings reared together, but differentiated now by age, right? So different ages bring different effects on them, right? At different times, they'll be doing different things. The environment will treat them differently as a function of age. And what you see is the further up you go, the less similarity you're going to find, even in the same environment, which is what you would think it is. It's just giving you pause to realize that heritability is not what a lot of people want to make it out to be. It's not written in stone. It doesn't have definitive implications about what you'll see. You've got genotype, and then you got phenotype. You got what you have the potential for genetically, and then what you have in actuality is what's been expressed, what's manifested, which is a wide range beyond what you might kind of naively assume would be the case. with things like eye color or hair color or skin color. People are like, man, you don't look anything like your mom or your dad. What's wrong with that? Nothing. Why would you assume that they would? How many brothers or sisters or brothers and brothers or sisters and sisters do you know that don't really look alike? Different heights, different hair color, different eye color, different skin tone. And then you want to get something that's so complex as intelligence and assume that there's a one-to-one relationship between a mother and a father and an offspring. It doesn't make sense if you're more sophisticated in your processing of information on this. Degree of variation of a trait within a population that's due to heredity. For intelligence, most research suggests it's 30% to 50% at most of the variation is due to heredity, differences in outcomes. Because it's not 100%, this means that heredity and environment interact to determine intelligence. Nature and nurture, not nature or nurture. And then we have reaction range. Genetically determined limits for an individual's intelligence where the quality of the environmental experiences determine where the individual will fall within this range. So this is for anything. Look at my height, for example. There's a reaction range of height. If I'd eaten more protein and exercised more, or more other nutrients growing up, I might have been 6'1 or 6'2. I'm 6 feet. Right? If I'd had worse nutrition, worse exercise, I might have been 5'8, 5'9. But I wouldn't have been 5 foot or 7 foot, right? Because the genetic program within me is programming for a range. I don't know what I could have gotten to, or I don't know what I would have fallen to under other circumstances. But we see in intelligence, when people are abused or neglected, they don't get what you would predict in terms of intellectual abilities. When they are deprived of stimulation, when they are deprived of love, when they are deprived of educational opportunities, probably what you get is something in the lower echelon of their range. But given great opportunities, great support, great love, all kinds of infusion of support and resources, you might get the upper end of their range. But for a variety of reasons, you might see it go one way or the other. So the range simply says that you're not guaranteed to hit a point on a test that we already know has a little bit of measurement issues with it, but that you'll go somewhere in that neighborhood probably in your lifetime for various reasons. That's all you need to know for your next test, y'all. Study hard. No good luck, because luck never predicted good performance on a test. Knock it out. Have a good weekend. I'll see you next Wednesday. Kyle will be with you on Monday.